Wash away my troubles, wash away my pain, with the rain and shambala. Wash away my sorrow, wash away my shame, with the rain and shambala. Oh, ooh, yeah, 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 yeah,
Ferguson, and I want to present to you the all-new Mission Snowmobile helmet by CKX. This helmet is equipped with AMS technology, and it redefines the trail riding experience. The Mission helmet is the result of 3 years of R&D, dozens of prototypes, and ultimately, 3 patents. The Mission is the first helmet equipped with AMS technology that helps to efficiently remove moist exhaled air, thus significantly reducing the risk of fogging, accumulation of frost, and condensation. The snowmobiler therefore benefits from a drier and cleaner inner space, resulting in unparalleled comfort. The CKX Mission helmet is available in several graphic designs, in a carbon fiber version, and with the electric shield option. To learn more about how the AMS works, go to ckxgear.com. Thank you, and happy trails.
That this number is not accepting calls. How you doing, man?
Good, good, excellent, excellent.
How's things in frosty land?
It's not very frosty. It's going to be plus today.
Holy crap! Yep. Yeah, they've had the perfect combination of snow, really cold temperatures, packing it all in, and nobody from the GTA coming up to ride. So.
Yeah, but now they're all locked down. I don't know if anybody, like, nobody can actually leave and go snowmobiling or come up there. Allegedly.
Yeah, not supposed to, but a lot of people riding. Notice how Facebook pictures are really quiet this winter.
Yeah, nobody's bragging that they're shredding in Muskoka or Cochrane or something.
No, yeah. They're down here ripping up the wheat fields. Idiots.
Good. Yeah. Yeah. Welcome back to the Snowmobiling Podcast. This is your host, Gord Van. And today joining me, my old buddy, Phil Molto. We teamed up for many years at Snowgoer Canada and Snowmobile Television. And he's just the perfect guy to talk about with this podcast. Phil is working at a BRP dealership now, and he knows our next guest really well. Just a point on, when we were going to snowshoot, our last day, the Europeans would come in with their crowds to test all the new sleds at Snowshoot, and this gentleman coming up is he's one of the friendliest ones that we had a chance to meet with. We didn't get a chance to really associate too much with them, Phil, but they're always outgoing and very friendly to us, and it was just really nice to get a different flair about snowmobiling. But Par Lindgren is the editor from Skoter Magazine, and we're gonna have him on. But first, Phil, you're working at a Skidoo dealership now, and Skidoo just released their 2022 sleds. What was the feedback of that? I mean, you guys were just watching the intro, and the phone started ringing.
It was absolutely crazy. You know, you and I've been around the sport for decades. You know, we go back to the 70s. I've never seen it like this. I mean, we've seen peaks in the 70s, the 80s, 90s, wherever you get an 8 or a 9 year cycle, there's a lot of sales, but nothing like this. I mean, like every other dealer, we have nothing, no used, no new stock. We have a waiting list for next year in all areas as well. You know, Sea-Doos, ATVs, Skidoos, everything has got a waiting list. I've never seen anything like this in motorsports ever in my life. It's absolutely, it's fantastic. I mean, we always talk about, you know, how do we get rid of new old stock, 1 and 2 year old sleds? How do they finance it? That's just not a problem anymore. Everything is sold. Doesn't matter what year it is, people are on the phone wanting it.
Yeah. So tell us about you're watching the intro, the Skidoo intro, and you're in the office with the manager and owner Dave Vincent, and all of a sudden your phone started blowing up.
Yeah, it's funny because we're trying to watch the content and there's just this constant binging of the phone. I mean, everything, you know, the phone ring, the text, the emails, like his phone just kept lighting up his computer screen. Like we're trying to watch it and just so much excitement. I mean, and kudos to BRP. When you and I are in the media for years, we've ridden all four manufacturers, but huge kudos to BRP for every year there's something new. You never see the bold new graphics or brand new graphics being launched. There's always a new product coming out, and they're just not slowing down. And this year was another, both with the Moxie and the introduction of the Lynx to North America. You know, BRP Skidoo just don't slow down. Every year they just come out with something new. To, you know, every year it's a surprise as to what's coming out.
Yeah. So, give us a kind of a little sense of what the feedback was. I mean, you had all your loyal customers calling. What were they most interested in? Are they trading their old sleds in for like a mock or the Lynx, or what? I mean, what do you think the most excited product was? Kind of thing.
Well, we've seen a lot of, you know, how do you say it? There's almost a trend going in the last few years. You know, Dave's always had his loyal customers. They always spring order because they want the X package. They always want the Renegade. They want the XRS. They want that 850. They want the newest technology. You know, when the R-Motion X came out, they want that for the next year. So they're always lining up for what the newest product is. But now there's so many things happening. You know, we've got the proven, you know, R-Motion X, the new RazX front end. And then you've got, you know, when the 850 was launched, now with the different turbo options. Now you've got the Moxie, now you've got Smart Shocks, and you've also got the Lynx. So the loyal customers who always walked in every year, you know, putting the order in and, you know, commitment in March saying, I want this sled for next year. Well, now they're really doing their math because they're looking at, do I want the Lynx with the Ultimate Shock package? Do I want the launch of the Moxie? Or, you know, do I want the Ultimate Trail Shock package with the Smart Shock? So they really got their thinking to do this year. You know, there's not just one sled. They've got multiple sleds that could be the ultimate ride for them next year, and they lock in right away. You know, these are people every spring they've got to order in, and they want to ride the newest and the best for next year.
Yeah. So what do you think? Was there more people call about the Mach, because that sounds like a friggin' incredible machine with the launch control and the Lynx. You sell a lot of MXEs and XRSs there. You know, what were most people really most excited about?
I think everything. People want the ultimate trail package, and they also want the ultimate launch package, and they also want the ultimate shock package of the Lynx. You know, in Ontario, we've got such a diverse riding area. I mean, from the south, where, you know, we are lots of big open fields, lots of, you know, places to stretch your arms. You get up into Muskoka, a lot of those trails get beaten up on a Saturday, Sunday afternoon, so you need an ultimate shock package. And when you get the lakes and you've got a 5 mile run down the lake, you don't want to be last. You know, everyone wants that pride of who's first down the lake, so that's where the Moxie kicks in. So you've got applications for all top of our sleds, you know, right through the whole spectrum. You want to, yeah. You want a short track, a long track, you know, what do you want, 850? Do you want the turbo? Do you want to be running in, you know, there's so many options now to consider. You know, back in the day, you had the Blizzard 9500 Plus, or you had the Formula Plus, and then the Mach 1. Today's market, there's so many options for what we would be considered the ultimate ride.
Let's talk about videos. You've been doing a lot of videos for the dealership. Tell us about them. What are you accomplishing that? You're doing all kinds of comparing old to new and stuff like that. Tell us about that.
Well, it's really interesting because, you know, you and I are both in the media, and the big question was always, what content do the readers want? And also you have to think about what content to the advertisers, distributors, you know, with the page layout. So content, what goes in a magazine or what goes in a TV show? I mean, there's so many different approaches and, you know, and ideas and what will work, especially in today's climate. So here at the dealership, I look at what we have available from BRP, all the divisions, Can-Am, you know, on-road, off-road, Sea-Doo. They do a great job of producing videos and working with their product ambassadors. So it's really hard to do videos that can do stuff other than what they're doing, because they've got access to the latest. They've got, you know, pull-up production crews. They really do an excellent, excellent job of producing great corporate videos. I mean, in the world of YouTube, we see a whole bunch of people out there who in their garage doing videos and stuff, and there's nothing like seeing a professional video from a company with ambassadors who just ride the product and are passionate about it. You know, BRP's got passionate Sea-Doo riders, off-road, Can-Am, you know, side-by-side ATV people, the people who love to dig in the mud with the XMRs. So they've got people who are passionate about every area of riding, and they utilize that with real professional videos. So here at the dealership, I look at it, I think, I can't really do what they do because they do it so well. So I produce content that it gives us a history of the sport and a lot of niches, because like you and I, we go back to the 70s in the sport. Well, a lot of people are just getting into it or have only been to it for a couple of years and don't know the old history, you know, that Skidoo had the motor ski line and what the differences were, or changes in technology from free air, liquid cooling, suspension, leaf springs, IFS, you know, the rev. There are so many things, and there's so much content, because people say, how do you come up with it? And I said, I'll walk through the shop and I'll see something on a sled or a Sea-Doo or one of the spiders. Are they, you know what, a lot of people really don't understand where that came from. So I'll do it. And a lot of people say, I didn't know that existed. I didn't know where that technology came from or when and why. I didn't know that was done back then. You know, a big hit was I did a video recently on the side-by-side Elite. And people didn't know that that sled existed. And then people who got them say, I forgot, I got to get mine out and ride them. And so many people are posting and creating a whole new level of excitement about a product that's been, you know, shelved for many people for years, just sitting in the garage. So out they come, creating more excitement.
Yeah, yeah, sounds good. Hey, did you hear anything from Mike Schmidt at all? What happened on the weekend at the Snowcross race?
I've been trying to find out more, and I feel... You got to really feel for not just snowcross racers, but all racers, motocross, people who want to hit the flat tracks, is that they're really caught in lockdown situations where half of their competitors they can't race with. So it makes it really tricky to race when either you can't get there or your competitor can't, because you're waiting to line up on the start line, different brands, different teams, like old, the guy that you're always racing against. There's somebody not there, so it's a really mixed emotions. I'm on the social media trying to track down who's doing what, and it's just an odd feel, as in with so many other sports right now, because not everybody's there and you haven't got the fans, so it's a strange feeling at the track. So even if you win, it's an odd feeling that not everybody's there, or without the fans, there's no drive-by, you know, of the fans. It's a really strange feeling at the track, and also. Yeah. We play it week by week. They don't know if they can race in 1 week or 2 weeks. And if they can, who can get there from what regions? If there's lockdowns in one area, but not another. So it's a real, they just want to race. So you got to give full credit to racers. They're just passionate and they just want to race.
Yeah. Yeah. The race directors this year, man, Ken, you know, my brother Ken, president of the CSRA, I mean, he's been telling us what's involved, you know, with putting on races this year, and the early season podcast we did with all the race directors, that was only just a taste of what these race directors have to go through. I mean, whether you're the USSA or ISOC or CSRA or you know, Eagle River, I mean, it's just you have to contact the health units and stuff like that. But the CSRA was having their first race this past weekend. And, you know, we're at the end of February and they're having their first race. And then the day before they have the first race, they get the message that, the Muskoka, Simcoe Health District is locking down. So, you know, the top four pro competitors live in Muskoka, the champion last year and three of the other top racers, we don't know if they're going to be able to race, you know, because they're not allowed to travel, and the health unit is going to be at the, you know, the gates at these races, checking residencies. So it could be a really, really tough year, you know, if going forward this year kind of thing. So I got to get in touch with my brother. I mean, so obviously he's still getting back and rearranging things from last weekend, and then he goes back to Lindsay again. So Yeah, we'll have to see. That's why I wanted to see if Mike Schmidt had any
whole
word.
Other side to that too, as you know from being on the track, you could have five racers working out of one trailer. Well, what if three of them can't get there? Well, it's pretty hard for a team to get there for two racers, or your novice racers are allowed, but the pros can't make it, or vice versa. You've got this whole race team, but if half of them can't get to the track or can't leave their area, that throws a whole wrench into the whole feasibility of, you know, five racers working out of a trailer, but only two can actually get to the track.
Yeah. Oh boy. Well, I hope something gets fixed because that could be. I mean, you know, it's going to be tough. You know, they have a couple races that Lindsay and you know Barry and Timmins and stuff, and you know, if the health units say, you know, those racers can't come and travel, it's the same as, I mean, we're going through the same thing with our recreational snowmobiling too. I mean, there's been lockouts and, you know, OPP and the police services at these regions have been actually ticketing people for coming snowmobiling in that region. If you're not in that health unit, if you don't live in that health unit region, then you're going to get a ticket for it's almost like you're trespassing.
And you bring up a really interesting point there. With the internet, people are getting mixed messages about what you can and can't do. And people say, well, you can just ride right through. And other people say, no, you're getting ticketed. And people say, well, you can't ride this area, but you can that, because we saw where Perry Sound was locked down, but areas north and south of it weren't. So you're looking at an area, and it's like, well, you know that they can groom and pack trails and they could be open, but they're very hesitant because nobody wants to, you know, be, you know, go against the rules. But the rules seem to, the rules changed. And people's opinions and interpretations of it also change. So it's been a very trying winter. And, you know, kudos to anybody involved in motorsports in this last year, whether you're on, you know, pavement, dirt, snow, just, you know, the constant change and information change and policy changes, like incredible dedication.
Yeah. And for people that really don't know what we're talking about, if you go on the OFSC interactive trail map, you can see actually what they're doing is the different health units, there'll be trails, and then there'll be a red closed trail in between the two health unit zones. So there's just all these like little red things where a trail is closed so that you can't go in. It's like you can't cross over the border of an international border kind of thing. And on our interactive trail map, they're all over. They're all over the that trail map showing, you know, that's a different health unit and area, and you should not be going in that next area. Now, a lot of people are kind of ignoring it. Phil, you were mentioning also that people aren't posting their travels, their snowmobiling travels, their trips on social media this year because they're gonna get razzed by their friends or whatever, saying, hey, how come you're traveling to Cochrane or wherever, Muskoka, you know, when, and you're not supposed to. So people are being really quiet about that.
Yeah, it's very interesting. The look of where I'm riding pictures aren't existing, like in front of the trail signs and the hotels. People are posting those signs.
It's kind of nice that your Facebook timeline isn't filled with people and all their travels, but people aren't kind of showing their friends where they're going kind of thing. So
it was very interesting the way the districts and clubs had to handle that. Like you say, you would look at the map and you'd see sections where you couldn't get from one health region to another, but depending where some people lived, they could be in a corner of an area, say Haldeman, you know, and they're in a corner where they can't ride anywhere, because if they go 2 kilometers either direction because of where they are, they're going to be in trouble. Where somebody else, if they're in the middle of, say, Gray County, well, they could ride all day and never have a problem. But if you're further south, suddenly you're caught where you would have to crisscross between regions, which you're not supposed to do. So, yeah, where you live was a real, could be a real bonus or a real problem this year.
Yeah, it's such an unfortunate too. You know, of all our luck, you know, Ontario and Quebec have had their best snow conditions in, you know, 10 years that I can recall. You know, the amount of snow they've had this year and the trails and you know, the clubs have been doing a fantastic job of, you know, no matter what, they're grooming the trails, you know, remarkably well. And they just can't entertain the snowmobilers.
No, And again, the work that the volunteers have done at the club level is absolutely astounding. The reroutes they've had to, you know, rerouting of trails they've had to do because of trespassing or weak fields or just bad weather and bad luck. You know, it's amazing how they keep the trail systems going year after year. And people notice they've given up their Saturdays and Sundays to go out and cut brush trail, you know, build bridges and stuff. And the amount of work it takes when you're out there is just astonishing. But the more people that help, the less work there is for the few. So, you know, if people are enjoying riding this year, they're new to the sport, call your club next year, volunteer. You know, it's only, you know, a lot of people, it's only one day a year they need you, and that's great. Just help stake certain fields or help clear brush on one section of trail. That's all they need to really lighten the workload for the volunteers.
Yeah, for sure. So, okay, Phil, well, what we'll do is I'll let you jump off the line there, and you can go back to work for half an hour or something. I told Parr that you were going to go in and clean the washroom. And he said, LOL. Yeah. So,
how did he know that's actually what I do for a living? I've been taking your crap for years. I'm able to clean washing for a living.
Well, you have been posting what you do at work there. So, he is one of your followers. So, he probably knows exactly what you do. So he's, and his sense of humor is incredible. So, I'll let you go, and then we'll get back to you. And as soon as Parr, picks up his kid, and because he says it's 3:30 there his time in Sweden right now. So that's, you know, time to pick up your kids, and when he gets home, he's gonna drop me a message, and I'll give you a call back, and then we can have a talk with Parr Lindgren.
Talk to you real soon, buddy. Take care.
Okay. Yep. Take care.
What language are we using today?
What's that?
Are we using English or Swedish?
Oh, we're doing English.
Okay. Okay. This will be good.
Yeah. Okay. You might be muted for a second until we get them on here. Calling to Sweden.
Is it Par with an S or Par without an S?
Yeah, it's Par.
It's Par. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hello. It has an S, but it's Pars or Par.
Oh, hello, Par.
Par. Par or Par?
Par.
Exactly.
Have we got him on?
Yeah. Par is how it's. How they say here in Sweden, but I always say Par when I go abroad.
Yeah. Well, welcome to the show, Par. It's great to have you on. You know what? I did a post a week ago or so about the Lynx competing in Ontario, Canada here back in the 90s or the 80s. The 80s, uh-huh. Sorry, with Polly and Polly Pippola. And so I had so much response from people from Europe about that post. I said, God damn, I gotta get somebody on here and satisfy my listeners, because I can only rehash posting pictures for a little time before I have to give them some real content. So we're digging down and Phil says, well, call Par, you know, he knows everything and everybody in Europe. So
that's good. He's a nice guy. I mean, he's really put up on the pedestal here.
Yeah, he's all right.
Snowmobiling, I learned from Par.
Yeah, sure. And you know, like the chicken too, huh?
Oh,
yeah.
So Par. I always said your group was the fun group at Snowshoe. You guys are always smiling, always having fun. So it's great to hear your voice again, sir.
Yeah, great to hear you too.
So let's bring everybody up to date here. So Par Lidgred is you're the editor of a Skoter magazine.
Yeah, exactly. I'm the editor in chief and the owner of the Team Sno Skoter here in Sweden. And we just this past autumn we also acquired Skoter Norge, which is the Norwegian snowmobile magazine.
Right. So tell us about it. Tell us about your magazine. You distribute to all of Europe, or are you in other countries too? Tell us about the magazine.
Mainly, the Tinne Snow Scooter is mainly based in Sweden. We do send it also over to Norway and some parts of Europe. It's not that big there, but I mean, we have our base of readers in Sweden, Finland, and Norway. And then Scooter Norge is obviously, it's a Norwegian magazine, so there we have also a lot of readers in that country too.
Yeah. And it's and you print in language so it's not in English, right?
No, that's correct. We do both magazines in Swedish and I mean the Tinne Snö Skoter is based in Swedish and in Sweden, so I mean it's mainly what we do. The Norwegian magazine we do both have Swedish articles and also Norwegian articles in it, so we got both. So it's kind of interesting, yeah. Actually, to work in two countries.
So how many issues do you do a year?
We have 6 issues a year, 92 pages in each issue. So we try to get a broad picture of what the audience and the readers want. I mean, not everyone is a snowcross driver. He's not interested. Maybe everyone is not interested in driving in the snow, in the powder, and that type of stuff. So we try to keep the magazine very wide when it comes to the readers, so every reader can feel at home in the magazine. That's one important thing that we do.
So what is the majority? What do most people like in European snowmobiling? I know you have a huge racing background in Europe. But this is the part of the podcast. We want to get to know what since you've been thrusted into our sport here in North America now with the introduction of the Lynx, we got to get to know you guys now.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we got a major part now when we are throwing in Lynx in the North American market. I mean, yeah, it's kind of interesting with that. And I mean, but the majority of the drivers here in Sweden are, I mean, it's not much different with the U.S. I think we're doing mostly the same type of riding. Trail, we go a little bit longer just to sit and enjoy and go out in the mountains just and relax. And some people, they go out and just do a lot of deep snow riding too. So I find it kind of similar how we ride. The thing that I think is different between the U.S. and Sweden is actually the snow conditions, how the snow is, and how it can change very fast in the U.S. from one day to another, and that type of thing. So that's a little bit about how I see differences, but also how things are similar between the two different countries or that we have.
Okay, Phil.
Well, I just got to say, it was always interesting at Snowshoe watching Parr's group because we'd come down the groomed trails and there's these guys in the red coats with really cool bandanas, you know, sitting in the trees and off in the jumps. And I was like, these guys don't like riding trails. What's wrong with them? Maybe we're just taking up the whole trail and they don't want to ride near us. Parr, just go on. Like, how did, when you would show up at Snowshoe, what sleds did you want? How did you evaluate them?
Well, we rode every sled we could get hands on. I mean, we were a pretty big group out there, about 5 to 7 people that went there every year. And so we tried to get both trail sleds and the deep snow sleds and the crossovers and mainly try to get all the kind of groups together. So we didn't have one trail sled with a deep snow sled. So that's mainly, but I mean, we went riding pretty far and try to get the most out of the impressions of the machines to us. And I mean, when we were there, we could always find the conditions that was perfect for the sled. I mean, if we were riding the trail sled, we could find it somewhere. I mean, trails, it was all over the place. The thing was the deep snow sled. But I mean, when we were in West Yellowstone, you could always find deep snow somewhere. So it was always I mean, we went always to a place where we knew we had the right conditions for the sled, and always tried to evaluate it between different people and working as tight as we could with the time frame that we had. I mean, it's not that big time that we have with the sleds, but we try to utilize it as much as we could.
So it was always interesting watching your group, because you guys, you know, you're always seem to be off in the trees and off on the jumps and stuff. And was it interesting for you to come over and have the access? Because we have in North America, did you get all the makes, models from all the manufacturers, or was it more of a narrowed down selection because of your geography there?
We could get pretty much every sled that we wanted to, but I mean the number of sleds that are offered in the United States are much. There are many more sleds. Some of the manufacturers only bring over maybe part of the sled models to Europe, but it differs. It differs between the manufacturers. I mean, some of them try to make us have every type of sled here in Sweden and Europe, but I mean it's a bigger market in the U.S. So. Sometimes we didn't need to ride every sled over there, because you got many more sleds, actually.
Well, it's funny, talk about what's available as sled models. I've actually got the Lynx in the back of the truck. I work at a BRP dealership, and I've got a Lynx in the back of the truck. While we were just talking, some guy just showed up, started taking pictures of the sled.
Yeah.
Get to ride it. We've had customers arriving, and they can't believe the suspension. So as soon as we're done this phone call, I've got that property right nearby a dealership here. So I'm going to be out in the fields and the big drifts and the big warps putting it through its paces. But what do you think about Lynx coming to North America?
I think it's kind of interesting, because I was at the 50-year anniversary of Lynx. It was in 2018, excuse me. And I was sitting there with Beaujolais, the VP of BRP, and I was asking me actually the question, when are Lynx coming to North America? And that year he told me, well, we don't have plans for that. I mean, now we're 3 years later, and now that we see that Lynx has actually gone to the North American market, and I think it's they should have done it a couple of years ago, maybe. Maybe it wasn't the right time then. I don't know, but Lynx is a good sled. I mean, it's been around since 1968, and I mean, it's developed through all these years. A different path than everyone else, because they were that. The Lynx sled was a little bit later into deep snow than everyone else was, but I mean, they've caught up now with the Boondocker DS and that's the sled. But I mean, they were good, have been good all through the years with the cross sleds and the trail sled actually with the suspension. And I mean, we're talking about Paolo Pippola that was out racing. I mean, that's the guy who made this suspension possible for him. So it's kind of interesting how he made that one happen.
Yeah, so it's incredible, Par. When Skidoo had the introduction here on their social media pages, Phil and the owner of his dealership were sitting in the office watching the introduction in the office, and the phones just started blowing up of people wanting this Lynx, and how can I get a Lynx? And they announced that there was going to be demos coming out, and now just about every dealer's got one now. So like Phil says, it's just been crazy about the interest of a Lynx finally coming to North America. And that's what all everybody's talking about is the Lynx. So, we're going to let you talk about, what is special about the Lynx, and reason why, maybe it's the mystique of this, not being able to have it for so many years, but, talk to us about the Lynx brand. I mean, you've ridden them all your snowmobile career.
Exactly. I mean, I was 16 years old when I started riding snowmobiles, and I think even that year, so it was a Lynx that I sat on. So, I mean, they've been around since 1968, and They made their first snowmobile that year. They started out actually 67 with some prototypes, but 68 is the year they really started. So they've been mainly, throughout the years, in the beginning, they were like trail riding sleds, work horses, that type of work sleds that they made. And then they started to trail riding sleds. And I mean, the brand itself has always had a big known name for being a robust sled. And you can go out with it and you can, like the 5900, which is a very known model, you used it to go out and in the woods, actually, to bring home wood. And it was a really good workhorse. And then they started out making sleds for trail riding and really tough and hard trail riding. And that's where they came from. They throughout the years they had, it was actually two brands, Lynx and Abinha, who combined and became the biggest selling company in Europe. That's kind of interesting. It was around 1980 that those two combined and became the Lynx, actually. They've been doing that for a lot of years. I mean, the actually trail and workhorses and developing their own techniques and everything and chassis and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Here in North America.
So you've had.
Oh, go ahead. Go ahead, Gord.
No, go ahead, Phil.
You always finish first on the sledge. You might as well finish first with me. my question is going to be, Carr, over in Sweden, what's the response been like over the last few years and the trend with four strokes? Because we're seeing a very popular in the BRP line with our 1200s are popular, the 600, the 900 ace with the turbo, non-turbo. What's the response like in Sweden to four strokes versus the traditional 852 strokes?
I think the 852, the two-stroke 850 is still popular. We've seen that the 900 ace with the turbo also is getting more and more popular. Maybe more trail riding and that type of stuff because that's the model that it's in. So it's getting popular, but I think most people today are into deep snow riding that actually buy new sleds. So I mean they're still into the two-stroke 850 engine and that kind of segment.
That's interesting. Yeah, Gordon, nice. Gordon, I've done the two-stroke, four-stroke, on-trail, off-trail, and the appeal of four-stroke, for various reasons on-trail. But when you try to get off-trail, the weight on the front end, and I guess for you, because you do so much off-trail riding and powder riding over there, it'd be similar to people here out in Alberta and British Columbia, where the four strokes are great on the trail, but in the deep powder, it comes down to power weight and power band. Is this
yeah,
over there?
Exactly.
Is that
what you think? Yeah, it's the same here. I mean, a lot of people love the four stroke when it comes to trail riding. I got guys calling me also and asking. And the thing is that most of them are the trail riders. They want the four stroke because they think it's a good mileage, gas mileage on it, and that's what they're looking for. And they want to go far, and they're not that often that they hit the gasoline pumps up in the mountains actually. So they want to have that thing with the four stroke. So it's mostly trail riders that use that one, or people go fishing and that kind of stuff. They like the four stroke.
Off trail, on trail over there, hard pack. Are studs a popular option over there, or ice ripper tracks in any way? Like, what's the popular track choice over there for riding? What combination?
We don't have that much studs actually here in Sweden. We don't use that. I don't know if it's just why we don't, but it's just like it's very seldom that people put studs on the tracks. They rather change the lug height on the sled actually and do that type of things. But but that's mostly because they want to go off trail riding and maybe sometimes on trail riding, so that therefore they get a higher log on the track just to meet both demands that they want to ride.
Now, in Skoter magazine, yeah, we see these fantastic pictures of the off-trail powder riding. What's it like over there for access to the backcountry and regulations? You know, we see the pictures, so it looks like, you know, you can ride pretty well, you know, back and forth to the seas and not have a problem. What is your riding areas like over there for regulations?
We have some areas that are regulated. Listed as it, so we know where not to ride. Pretty much you can ride wherever you want to when it's not regulated. You just need to have the snow packed so it's not little snow. You need to have a mount so you don't damage the vegetation under it. So that's mainly the way that we could ride here. It's been a lot of discussions regarding these rules that we have. That is somewhat not clear, but they are still enough clear that you can ride a snowmobile on snow, and as long as it's not a forbidden zone, then you can ride it. And that's the regulations that we have. It's pretty good, but I mean with the good that we have, it's a lot of responsibility too, that the rider does really behave good when you're out there. Then we have other rules. When we're riding, you can't ride in certain areas along with the regulated ones. I mean, so that is just general rules, which is when you have taking down the trees so you don't have any trees on an area, then you can't ride on that one because you probably have planted new trees under it, and if you ride on it, they will be ruined, actually. So, but that is some other regulations, yeah.
You're riding, okay. are you when it comes to helmets, are you guys goggle people or visor people, heated visor people, or because you're standing up so often, I'm curious what you actually wear for face protection and then eye protection and keeping clear?
We got goggles, and then we have this helmets, not visor helmets, just helmets like with a chin protection guard in front, that type of protection, more or less like that you are doing in the summertime when you're doing motocross racing, and goggles. And a lot of people now are turning into using heated goggles, electric heated goggles, because that's really good when you don't have to have the fog on them, so you get rid of that one. So it's kind of, but that's mainly, I mean, you in Sweden you have to have a helmet when you ride snowmobiles. You can't be without it. So it's that's another regulation that we have to obey.
Good, sir. Yeah.
So Par. Okay, so Par, the last time I was in Europe, we went over there for Snowgore, and that was in 2005, and you were introducing a trail system called the Arctic Trail, where it went from Sweden to Finland and Norway, and we completed that trail, and it was absolutely beautiful. Mm-hmm. Do they still have that
system, they do.
That trail system?
Yeah, they do. In Sweden, we built, we got a lot of trail systems here, which are, it is like snowmobile clubs that are maintaining them, and so we got a lot of trails that we can ride both from the coast where we live up to the mountains, and you can go north and south, and a lot of people do that, especially in the springtime. Then you take out your four stroke, as we were talking about earlier, and you want to go those long rides, and so you go on these trails north, south, east, west from where you're staying, and doing that, and it's hopefully sunny, and you have a great time with your friends, and that's a lot of people do that.
Yeah, that to date is the best trip I've ever done, bar none. Like nothing comes close to that that trip. You know, we went to the ice hotel, and
awesome.
It was just an absolute beautiful trip. It was I think we did it for like 8 days or something like that. Incredible. So tell us more or less about your trail systems. Are they mapped or are they staked now? Like, so, you know, you stay on that trail, and can people plan their trip, with a map?
Mostly. I mean, it is not that you have like this, type of organization that is putting together all the maps for the whole Sweden. There are some people or, kind of, people that I have sat down and put trail maps together, and they package it so you could put it into your GPS, and then you could plan it. Because a lot of trails are both state, and then you have the ones that are maintained by the snowmobile clubs here. So it's kind of the state state trails you can find on the general maps that are here in Sweden. But then when you get down to the smaller and the trail systems that are maintained by the snowmobile clubs, then you need to go into different clubs to look at their maps. Or there are some people that also has taken the effort to put together a map structure for Sweden. But I mean, those are probably 95% to 98% correct if you use that one. And then each year, trails are getting a little bit changed, and maybe they added a trail and that stuff. But those maps are really good, actually, to use.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Phil, are you still on? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We dropped Phil. So let me get Phil back on here.
Sure.
Par. Okay. Let's get him back on here. Where is he here?
I'm back.
I noticed it was awfully quiet there, Par.
Yeah, me too. I mean, when Phil is quiet, that doesn't happen. So, I mean,
there's something wrong.
We know
there's
when
something wrong if it's quiet.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, quiet Phil.
Yes.
So Par. Tell us, okay. So the big news has been that, you know, the Lynx coming to North America.
Yeah.
What do you think? I mean, you've come to North America to Yellowstone every year to drive all our trails and all the different sleds. What do you think people are going to their impressions are going to be of the Lynx model, the Rave LE that they're bringing here? What do you think they're going to like about the Lynx that particular model? And maybe what they may be surprised about the most.
I think that we will be really happy about the Rave RE because it's a fast, agile trail sled that is manufactured to go on bumpy trails. So if you got trail systems that are not always maintained and it's a little bit bumpy, or maybe you're a person that just rides bumpy trails because you like it, then you're gonna love the Rave RE because it's made for trails. Actually, I know that this year they developed the suspension too to PPS3 suspension just to get it a little bit softer, because in the Swedish and Finnish trail system we got a lot of bumps, so we ride it a little bit harder. So now that they actually made the PPS3 to be a little bit smoother. So maybe that might be the thing. I'm not sure how smooth it will be, if it's smooth enough for an American or North American person, because we have during the years we can see that a lot of sleds were actually made for going fast on very good trails. Maybe not that big mogul trails. Suspension wasn't really done for that. So it's gonna be. The people that are riding the PPS3 will probably be happy. I'm not sure how soft they got it, because that's what they wanted to do, is soften it up a little bit. So, but
go ahead and say it. Go ahead and say the part. We're soft over here.
Yeah, no, not really. No, you got good trails. I wouldn't say that. Yeah, I wouldn't say soft. You got good trails. That's the thing I always learn every year. I mean, when I went to the US and we we were just sharing, because now we knew that we could put the throttle to the bottom on every sled and we could ride it as fast as we wanted on the trails. So that was the fun part, actually, when riding on the Americans, North Americans trails. And that's what we love about it. So you're not south, it's just you got great trails. And I love it.
Yeah, we I seen one comment on social media. Somebody commented about in North America we design groomers to take the bumps off the trails, and Lynx design suspension to actually do go over the bumps.
Exactly.
So if you in the past, let's get a time frame here of say 2005, because that's where the suspension systems really started to grow, and the up to 2022 model. If you had to pick one Lynx sled that you just said, yeah, that is my favorite sled of all time, what would it be?
Actually, we would during that time period, I love the Boondocker DS, actually, because it was one of the first sled that got the shorty back end. So it was much fun, more fun to ride in the deep snow, because you didn't have any back part that got stuck in the snow, and so we were hanging the track. So I mean I think with the Boondocker, that was also when Lynx got not ahead, but they came back, since they were a little bit late with getting into the deep snow models. The Boondocker was actually one that caught up with everyone else with that one. So that's a sled that I like.
Yeah. So maybe you can tell the people over here. I mean, they don't know the name Polypipula. Or really the Lynx, really. But so tell us about Polly. I mean, he raced here when Snowcross first started here in the early 1980s. A person, a good friend of ours, brought a couple Lynx sleds over there, and they're the GLX 5500s, I believe they were. Yeah. And Polly came over to compete at the series, the Snowcross series here. Nobody knew him. Nobody knew about the Lynx sleds, really, what they were like. But I tell you, he made an impression over here. Right? He dominated Snowcross at the few races he did here. Basically, you know, the big names like Tim Bender and Jim Appleson and my brother Ken Avan, he dominated those guys and those sled brands quite easily. So tell us about Polly. You must know him really well.
Not really, but a little bit. I mean, we've been with him or known him since the racing, and he's, I mean, he's a big name. When you're talking about big snowcross racers, I mean, Paul is one of the guys everyone talks about. And Finland has brought a couple of ones in front, and that has been really good. And I mean, he raced a lot, and then he started out at the Lynx factory, and the thing that they wanted from him was to actually develop a really good suspension for them, and that's probably all his racing career all the experience he had from that one that went into the PPS buggy suspension that he developed. And I mean, that guy's track record is pretty fantastic. And I mean, it wasn't like nowadays when we see a lot of European guys going over to the States and race there. I mean, when Pauli did that, it wasn't that many that went over. I mean, it was really big news when someone went there. So he was really in front of a lot of other people and took a big step, actually, which is fun for us to know.
There hasn't been a lot of Europeans that have come here, but there's the ones that have come here, and even today, the ones racing on the on the ISOC circuit. They're making a big name. I mean, look at Ishuel. He's yeah. leading the points over here, the kind of thing. And the others like Ranheim and stuff like that. You know, these guys grew up, you know, over there, you know, racing the Lynx sleds, and you know, they make a huge impression over here. Phil, more questions?
Jump in on that. When the product launch came down, of course, they had to bring up Tony Hakkinen, his influence with the in developing and working with DRP, and then the successful marketing, because people in the 90s were looking for a ditch banger to do, and perfect combination of marketing and a great product by bringing Tony over here. I mean, his influence in riding style and endorsement was huge.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Sorry, we cut you off there, Par.
That's the big names that went over. I mean, when I read about them, I find it kind of interesting that they actually could go over, because I mean, it was so much harder when they did it. So it's kind of impressive that they both went over and then they made big names and did really good. I think a lot of it might have been doing with that they've been racing a lot here in Europe, and even though that the tracks maybe in the U.S. are a little bit more spectacular, that they adapted and just used all their skills and know-how from the racing here in Europe and got it to work in the U.S.
I find that very interesting, because in the 1970s we had ice oval racing, as did Sweden. But we didn't see the Swedish racers come here, but we saw how good they were. We sent our races overseas. So it was interesting seeing Snowcross, how we brought people over from Finland, Sweden to race here in Snowcross, because your riding and racing style was so different from ours.
Yeah. It was. And as you mentioned, you got a lot of oval races at that time, and it was... I know that there were a lot of, not a lot, but I mean, they brought over some Americans to Sweden and the oval racing here, and not only in Sweden. I mean, it was a competition that was in Sweden, Finland, that it was kind of combined. So it was kind of a couple of big names that came over here and raced. So it was kind of interesting too to see that the Americans also went over here.
And you notice that talking with Gordon and I is like riding snowmobiles with Gordon and I. We'll just keep cutting you off all day, because that's the way we ride and that's the way we talk. So,
so part.
One day on the trail, we still don't talk about it very often.
How's the racing scene there now? I guess you're just kind of kicking off. The past few weeks, haven't you?
That's correct. Yeah, I mean, it's been crazy with the COVID and everything here in Sweden. I mean, they had a racing schedule, and it's been actually put just upside down. And I think that all the scheduled races, not even one has been raced at the place they was planned to. Everyone has been moved so far, they will have a racing season here to crown a winner. But this year has been, well, crazy as in every country probably. I mean, they are racing, and it's good to see. And now they're televised or through internet actually, so we can sit and see every race, and I think that's good, because the racing scene here in Sweden has kind of gone down a little bit the past 10 years. So they're trying to do different things to make it more interesting. And televise it and have people seeing it through internet. And that is probably one way to go. And maybe sometimes a little bit shorter races, but they're doing a good job trying to get the audience back.
Yeah. So the few races that you've had this year, who's looking good? Like some names that maybe we can that we might steal from you in the future. Who's looking good over there?
Oh, you might get Marie Karin back. You never know. She's been off for two. Yeah, she's been off for 2 years actually. She got two babies, and now she went for the first race and she won the skating cross race, and so she's looking good actually. So that's kind of
really
interesting.
Yeah.
You never know. She might go back to the States and do another round there. So that's she's doing good. That's kind of fun to see.
Who's your factory Lynx and Arctic and Polaris drivers over there now? Is some big names? Who are we looking out for?
Their factory riders are, I gotta say, there are a lot of people that are not into names right away right now. Sorry for that,
yeah.
But. We don't know to see. Adam Renheim was out competing in the U.S. We'll see what he's doing. But he's missed out some races here in Sweden, so he probably won't be back there. And to race here, so that's. But I'm not that into that at this point.
Yeah. So what are you into? The past couple of weeks, you've been in the mountains. Is that what you like doing?
Like the mountains. We're doing some test rides up there, and so we go up to the mountains. We've been there for the past 3 weekends doing test rides we got project snowmobiles that we worked on, and so we this year we built 146 Polaris cows with a little bit different parts. We put on it, so we're up trying it out, see how it works, and if everything are holding together when we're riding it. So, and then we also have gotten some other sleds that we didn't get to ride during the springtime. So we've used some weekends to ride those two now. So we got some more to put in our magazine.
Yeah. So what kind of sled are you liking this year? What are you really leaning towards? What's your favorite sled this year?
I got actually two. I'm riding a Yamaha Mountain Max, and I find that really interesting. It's kind of agile. I like how it works. It's easy to ride. It pops out perfectly for me and my height, and because I'm pretty tall, I'm about 190 centimeters, and I weigh about 115 kilos. So my riding style is probably not like the younger guys. But I like the how it handles. Actually, it's a lot of different difference between that one, and we had the first Alpha also that 2019 Alpha one. So I got to compare them a little bit, and it's just really different. It's a total different sled this year with the Mountain Max. So it's really fun to ride. I also liked actually the Project Chaos that we are using, the Polaris. That's a kind of a fun sled, 146 with all that QD2 and 3-inch lugs on it. So it's a fun, happy sled just to go out and tips up Tuesdays and everything.
Yeah. Well, you have them too over there, do you?
Oh, yeah. Can't leave that one alone to you guys. We got to have it back here to you.
Yeah. Okay, Phil?
It's interesting listening to prior talk, because when the launch came down of the Lynx, that we had people from his side of the ocean discussing it. First of all, locally here, our riders found this thing just lights up in the moguls. Here in Ontario, we get trails that are groomed overnight, but by the middle of the afternoon, they're really whooped up. And they said this Lynx just came to life. But I want to know, how are we really supposed to say this? Because Lynx is said differently over there. So is stuff like LED lighting and track legs. How are we supposed to call this thing, Par? Give us the true word. How do we say it?
About it?
Lynx. How do you pronounce Lynx?
Oh, it's Lynx. And it's the Lynx, and I gotta make the Finnish guys proud when I say, you say rave, or it's a rave, actually. That's the pronunciation of the rave. So it's actually a guy that we meet every year from the Lynx department up in Rovaniemi. He used to ride sleds for a magazine, so he's very... very, very thorough when it comes to the pronunciation of the Lynx rave.
Good luck with that, Phil.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I think in North America, you need to say rave or something like that, because the rave, it sounds like some guy from I don't know where that's pronouncing it.
Yeah, Italy or something. Yeah, yeah.
I've got this Lynx rave loaded in the truck, and I'm excited to go riding today and really put this thing, because I've got an off-trail area where I can take this thing. It's 5 minutes from my
work,
so I'm really excited. And people keep coming up and taking pictures. I don't know if it's the sled or if it's me that's more famous. I think it's the sled.
It's probably you. I'll bet it's you, because you probably got the chicken dress on you, so everyone think it's Easter.
Well, and I'm so short, I've got the booster seat here in the truck, so I can see over the steering wheel, so that's probably drawing attention.
He's probably got his monkey. He's probably got his stuffed monkey on the handlebar too. There.
Yeah, exactly. The way we know him.
So, Par, you're not coming to North, but you're not coming to Yellowstone this year.
No.
I suspect, eh? Yeah, yeah. So,
unfortunately,
disappointed
not.
Or?
Yeah, that was a great event. I mean, the best event that we could go to, because we had all the sleds in one place, and so it was easy to get access to them. With the areas that we rode on, we could get every type of terrain that we needed for the sled. So it was a good 5-6 days that we could do a lot of work in a short time, and that we could bring back home. So we would have liked to go there every year, because that's the best event that we could get for this type of sled riding and testing that we do for a magazine.
So how are you, I said
at the beginning, but I'll say it again, Par, your group was absolutely a blast to be around. You guys promoted the sport, because you're always smiling when you ride. You know, a lot of people in the media, they're all like, gritty, gotta ride, gotta get this picture. Every time I see your group, you're always waving and smiling. You're the epitome of snow. I always enjoy seeing your group.
Yeah, we gotta stay positive. I mean, if you want to be crankier and you're riding the most fun vehicle in the world, then you're in the wrong place. I mean, you gotta be happy. That's the way.
Yeah,
that's all the way.
So how are you accessing the new sleds this year? I mean, last night the Polarises were introduced.
Mm-hmm.
How are you getting your sleds this year to test?
Yeah, we got the manufacturers are really good at getting them over here. But I mean, we don't have that many that we could get access to at the snow shoot. But they always see to that we can ride the new sleds, and they always take the upgraded sleds almost also to these events that they have here in Sweden. So we are getting a lot of the information and riding back here home, but it's kind of divided into different places, so it takes more time for us to go. And since we were kind of a tight group with the 5 to 7 people, it's not that easy to get the people together, since they don't work at the magazine full time. They have other jobs, so it's kind of messy sometimes to get the right amount of people to go. But we got sleds to ride here, so that's what I'm happy the manufacturer has done a good job getting those ready for us every year.
Yeah, have you had the Polarises was introduced over here last night. Have you had an opportunity to test the new Polarises yet?
Not yet. We're going actually on Thursday morning. We're heading off and we're going to ride them. So it's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah,
because
good.
I've been looking at the pictures to go through everything. And it's a lot of technical things that they've accomplished with a new turbo. And that's so it's going to be really interesting to ride it.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. They I guess they needed a turbo to, to compete with the Skidoo. You always have to have that edge with your manufacturer. Okay, yeah. Phil. Let's wrap it up with Par. You got any more questions?
No. Well, actually, I have one more question, Par. When you were in Montana in West Yellowstone, did you ever think it was possible to put any more meat on a pizza than they did at some of those bars?
No. The best thing is actually Michael. You know him, the little guy with all day. He makes a magazine. And he went into a Buffalo Bar or something that up there, and he was ordering a large pizza, and I told him, Michael, don't order a large pizza. It is large. I mean, this is America. They don't make small things. They make big things.
No.
And he was like, no, I want a large pizza. Okay, so you buy I'll buy it for you, but you'll eat it. And when he got it in, his jaw just dropped down. He's like, well, yeah, this one is big. He said, yeah, now you got to eat it. And he just even finished one third of it. And after that, he was full. So, I mean, it's a lot of meat. And it's good things that they have. Good pizza.
It's good for a week, and then you got to come home to a good salad.
Yes, exactly. Well, salad is not enough. You got to go out and run and do everything else after that week, because it takes a month to get in shape.
For listeners, you know, the experiences we had at Snowshoe together were just fantastic. Riding all day, seeing each other at night, laughing during the daytime, and that, you know, sitting together having lunch. So again, you know, great memories of snowmobiling with you at Snowshoe, sir, and all the best in your future endeavors. And I look forward to seeing more posts on Facebook. The internet's great for keeping in touch with you.
Yeah, it's great to hear you, and it was great to just meet you guys over there. It's the same feeling that we have. You were always fun, and you were always laughing and doing all these jokes with us. So, and that's good. That's how it's going to be, and it should be.
Okay, Par. So let's wrap it up here, but let's talk about your magazine. What do you got? What do you got coming up, and where can people find you on the internet?
Yeah, you can find us at www.scooter.se and social media too. Of course, I mean, everyone's there, and we're posting like crazy every time we ride.
Yeah,
that's what we want to do: show people how to ride and have fun. And what we want to get the feeling out to all the people out there. Have fun.
You got any exciting articles coming up maybe it might be an interest of us in North America?
Probably. I mean, we've got more Lynx snowmobiles that we're riding. So we for the North American people, they could probably go in and watch some pictures on social media and everything like that. And see what we're doing with the Lynx, the other ones, not the Boondocker or the Rave or the other models they have. So that's going to be quite interesting.
Yeah, the interest in that brand is just you just woke everybody up over here, with that introduction. So yes, if people want to see what else Lynx has in their model lineup, just go over to skoter.se and check out their magazine. It is in Swedish. But they have some remarkable pictures. You got some great photographers over there. What they're doing over there.
Yeah, thanks.
So, okay, Par, it was great talking to you, and hope to run across you again real soon.
I hope so too. It was really fun to be with you guys, and thank you for having this opportunity. I love it.
All right.
Great to
All right,
you
take
again.
Care,
have
Par.
Have a great day, sir.
You too, sir.
Yeah, bye-bye.
Bye.